Enterprise feedback management. So we help large companies design platforms that in real and deploy platforms that in real time gather all the interactions their customers are having. They measure feedback in real time, and in real time they distribute across all the ownership, products, segments, and individual customers the feedback, so that you get a setup that is managing a proper dialogue that will then improve customer experience and customer lifetime value. And here also we use Bayesian Hub. We start using Bayesian Hub to trigger smart actions. So you would not react only to what is called a detractor because he gave a zero, but you would start reacting on something smarter than just a score, which is a scoring that tells you, given the feedback, what is the probability that the person is really at risk and so on. So we try really to take advantage of Bayesian Hub in any possible application. We also do marketing research, which is still half of what we do, but there are people that will talk about marketing research later, so I will not focus on this in the cases. So our solution, the umbrella brand of everything we do in predictive analytics, is called OnTarget. Why? Because we use predictive to transform massive actions to an individual target. So with individual priority, we redesign processes, we improve customer experience, we reduce effort, we create measurable value, that's the goal. And how, in general, before going to the cases, we do it, is that we come in as external providers and consultants. We carry out an assessment, so we understand what is the business need, what are the processes, are we talking about churn, complaints, upsell, cross-sell, hiring new employees, retaining employees, and more or less whatever you can imagine if you have the proper data sets. So the point is, we start by taking a picture of processes, business needs, definitions, data sets, and establish an ROI. We then, with Bayesian, try to get advantage of all the possible data sets to crunch data and to predict the outcome that is today not predicted and is manage massively with average returns, and we start designing actions with clients so we understand the root causes of, let's say, complaints, because it's the first case we will see. So we understand why people complain, but the next stage is that because we understand who will complain and not just why, we can take actions, individual actions, not only our root causes. That's the key point. So we design actions, we pilot them, control samples, ROI, differential behaviors, and that's the end of the game. See, if the ROI is positive, you deploy. If not, you stop. But up to now, also thanks to Bayesian Lab, that we benchmark on all the data sets we have against a number of our solutions, we always produce positive ROIs, given the ability to predict and the level of cost we can put inside these projects. That's extremely important. So the first one is a case for a UK bank that is like full of people coming from General Electric and really good at doing root cause analysis. So they have huge teams worldwide and globally and so on, doing root cause analysis on complaints and every possible outcome or behavior, but here we're focusing on complaints. And what we're doing is like they take root cause analysis and they work on the root causes with traditional techniques. So it would take months to decrease complaints by 3%, by 4%, and every action takes months to deploy. So what we tested, this was on the Italian market, is that we said, okay, let's use Bayesian Lab to do the root cause analysis, because we thought it was smarter than what they are doing. And secondly, why should we only work on the root causes? Let's go predictive. So we know who will complain. Why can't we try to call the guy that is going to complain before he complains? Let's pilot. So I still have some technical slides just to look more like a Bayesian guy, but I'm all about the outcome. So the outcome is that overall we reduce complaints by 58%, which would have taken years of work to level. They would, I think with a traditional technique, they would even never have got there. People that went through the proactive process, they had plus 30% customer satisfaction, which is super difficult to achieve if anyone is familiar with customer experience. Not only, but if we take the ROI, because this has a cost, it's a very simple model, so the cost is very limited, but still it has a cost. So if we take the ROI on the direct cost of waiting for a complaint and managing the complaint reactively, or going proactive but adding the analytics layer, the cost is the same, more or less. It's comparable. The point is that you are reducing complaints by half, and that people are delighted, and that we could follow the cohorts of people that had the action and people that went through the proactive action. Actually, they churned 8% less. So for free, you are inventing delight and retention, because that was means if the direct cost is the same, it comes for free. You just work in a smarter way. That looks like scary. So when yesterday I met one top manager of a large telco in France, and he's a smart guy, but smart depends on expectation. He said, you need to simplify the way you sell to clients, because most clients wouldn't, and he was talking about slides like this. So I would love him to attend the session today, so that he understands how much we try to simplify. I had once a top seminar with the top 200 managers of my group. I put a slide with all sigmas and formulas. I was just kidding. So I said, okay. So that I lowered the expectations, so the next one, on the next slide, nobody could complain. So the model is super easy. So we had some dozens of variables, and we're highly predictive with just few variables. So we're dealing with complaints on a contact center. So it's just about who is calling, how many times, in different periods of time, why is calling, who is answering, what is the reason for calling. It's super basic, but still with something that works on Excel file, you are this predictive. So if you go random, you just cannot deploy the process. On the x-axis, you would have 100% of people that called in a month, let's say. And on the y-axis, you have 100% of the complaints that you get from the callers. So what we got is exploring this area, looking months after months, piloting actions at what was the return. This is the potential return, the red curve, so more or less 10, 35. So if we recall the first 10% of people that call the contact center that are more at risk, we can get in touch with 35%, so one third of the potential complainers, which doesn't mean that we solve, but we get in touch with them. So the important is to see that, is to consider this is one piece. The red is the model, the blue is the real behavior of the control sample. So first news, the model is really reliable. That's key, because I have other cases where clients were already targeting customer to reduce complaints proactively. The action was perfect, but the way they targeted individuals was so poor that they were actually increasing complaints because they were calling the wrong guys. So that's extremely important, because the way you think it's a bad idea, it was about bad targeting for them. And then once we deployed the actions, I'll show you in the next slide, we could go during 1 or 2 years with the pilot, improving the actions and exploring this area to see where we got the saturation effect and where the ROI is maximum we can achieve. So, to make something a little bit more complicated, but it's very easy. Control sample, so in a month we take a parallel sample of the on-target, what we call the on-target sample, and we just let them complain because we want to see how they complain naturally. So they complain at a rate of 3%. A much larger sample, obviously, because we deploy the action, so it's a cost to let people complain because we let them with a bad experience. Here it was after more than 1 year, so we were targeting the 30% of the people with the highest risk scoring. If you get in touch with them so you can deploy the action, they complain at 1%. If they are well targeted, but you cannot get in touch with them because you need to go fast, you don't have time to get in touch with all of them, they complain at 5% because they are at risk, but they are untouched. And then there are other very small figures to go back to the total, so the complaints of people that are not at risk enough, so that would cost too much to carry out the action on them. You do the total, and the total is 1.47% complaints, so it's minus 52. It can vary month by month, but that's the way. Then obviously inside an action, there are several thread of actions, so you will have this measure by reason for complaining and action to give an answer proactively. And now that's how the two key values look over time. The red points are the percentage of the X, so the amount of effort we put in, so how many people we call back. And the blue is the Y, so no, it's not even the Y, it's not how many people we got in touch with, it's a reduction in complaints. So while on the gain curve, it's how many people you call back, how many potential complainers you get in touch with, here is the result. So if I go back once back two slides here, if I call back 30%, I potentially get in touch with 70% of the complainers. And here I'm reducing with 30%, I'm reducing 52. So I'm wasting 18% of the potential, but an extremely good conversion rate. It means that 18 on 52, it's like 75% of the people I call that would have complained, they won't complain because I proactively cared. Okay. So obviously the client was very skeptical. That was 2013, he never heard of that. So we started very small, but with very small, we did minus 27% complaints. So we say, okay, let's ramp up. And then we reach a plateau and the action is still ongoing and deployed. That's it for this case. Any question? Non-technical? Are there measured complaints? There is a formal definition because everything is formal. So it's a person that has called the contact center and has either complained, or there is a very formal definition of people that are not saying they are complaining, but they're expressing themselves in a very negative way and so on. They have to be considered complaints anyway. So it's a formal definition, it's a global bank, and everybody in every country uses the same definition. So it was pre-classified, so we asked them how they would classify complaints. And we used their definition.
Do you look at natural language versus?
We do, but rarely, because honestly, in my experience, very few companies use the structured data they have in a proper way, in this optimal way. So I see data science team that are predicting, most of the actions are useless and the ROI is not even measured. So in my opinion, maybe I've done clients, but there is a lot to do that is much simpler than doing something that is much more complex and expensive, because we aim at an ROI. So if we increase the cost part, we need to have a gain that makes it positive. That's why we first aim at things that are very easy, very simple to do, because it makes it much easier for us to achieve an ROI. So yes, we start using text analytics, natural language, but the setup is very costly, so you need something very large. So we are now crunching data and we have a million to understand what we can do with, but it's still an exception. So we understand the potential, but if we have to produce an ROI, it's very rare that we use them. Just for economic reasons, for the financial results.
Okay.
In this case, what are all the variables we consider to predict, to understand and predict? The definition is all the data that the customer care manager had. So it's telephony data, the CRM backlog of all the interactions, the front office and back office interaction logs, so everything that is around what is happening and registered, officially registered within the customer care. Because it didn't, if we could have done even better, if we could have used the whole enterprise-wide data set, but we couldn't for political reasons, we didn't own the rest of the data. So I'm not sure I will answer correctly, but in this case it was pretty simple. The data set was very, very simple. The data preparation was more calculation over data that was not structured in a way that was meaningful for the model. Like you get a list of calls, but the call wouldn't complain. So you need to start transforming data into something related to a customer. So we built a relational database calculating variable out of the raw sources. I can give you an answer that is like completely different from other cases, not from this one, but in another predictive model for complaints, the presence or absence of the customer email address in the database is a predictor. So we would not input data when it's missing, because missing data is a predictor. Because in that specific case, there is no proper management information system, marketing information system, sorry. So the email identifies a younger or more recent customer that under the same stress condition is more reactive than the rest of the customer base. And I have other examples like this in this marketing world. The absence or presence of the mobile phone number of B2B, small business customers for a very large utility is a predictor for churn, because they have many sources of acquisition. One of the sources is physical networks. Some physical networks, they actually work honestly for their clients, so they would really acquire clients, customers for their clients. Some of them try to build their own customer base, and they would move this customer base across clients to get fees. So they would not give you the full data to get in touch with the end customers because they want to retain them. And through this missing data, we identified the honest agencies, the ones that were fired. We allowed the clients to change the commissioning system, the contracts, so we saved millions through one data that was missing. That's the fantastic marketing work. I don't know how much time I have, but I have just a few more slides. So the next one is about HR selection. So we belong to Teleperformance, so we also do things for ourselves. And we have around 200,000 agents in the contact centers, okay, out of the total. So I would like you to try to take some guess of, on average, around the world, what is the percentage of attrition? So what is the percentage of agents we lose and we have to select, train, and put in the operations to replace the one you lose? 20? 100? Per year. So it goes from 3% in some counties to 150 in others. So it means that over a year, we have, you multiply by 6 weeks, we have 1.2 million weeks of training worldwide. So that's why we came up with an HR predictive analytics platform that is identifying the probability that a candidate will be a high performer, where a high performer is a person that stays more than X and perform above a certain threshold. And the point is that it works extremely well, extremely well. So the point is that through a 100 plus questionnaire that is, let's call it a psychometric questionnaire, it took 5 years to build with tests all around the world, the questionnaire. We screen existing agents, we see how they perform. Okay, I make it easy, it's a whole team that is doing this, obviously. And we build profiles that can be related to what we call a job family. So who is a good selling agent, who is a good inbound customer care and so on. But that can go down to sales in a country, or that can go down to a specific program that is large enough to have its own model. The Philippines, where that's the country where we have most of our employees, 40,000, we have 11 different models. So if a candidate comes in, he takes a test, and in real time through a platform, he is attributed with individual probabilities to 11 programs to hire him on the one where he will fit best. And the fit has a number of advantages automatically, because let's say this way, the guy is less unhappy. If he's not more happy, he stays longer, he performs better, he's less sick, there is less absenteeism, and all the metrics of the KPIs, because unfortunately in the contact center everybody's measured whatever he does, customer satisfaction, first call resolution, which is the ability to answer and to give the right answer at the first call, quality assurance, whatever metrics is improved by 20-30%, even sales. So the sales agents that were selected with the model, if you compare them with the control sample that is selected without the model, so the same identical process, just without the Bayesian Lab platform information, they sell 20-25% more. Just because they fit with the job. And the exception is like we are learning a lot because we have a huge laboratory, so we do it on a million candidates a year, more or less, is that all the selection process we were using, interviews, psychologists, external tests, and so on, when you take the scoring that we calculate with Bayesia and you look at what is the distribution of the scoring in the candidate pool and what is the distribution of the scoring in the population hired without the predictive model, they're just exactly the same. So if we receive from the market 50% of future high performer and 50% of future low performer, without the predictive model, all the other part of the selection process, interviews, they select random. So that's why a lot of attrition, because you put people in a position they hate, and they just leave after maybe even just a month, 2 or 3. We might even lose up to 40% of the agents in the first 2-3 months. So it's a pretty difficult job. So you understood the principle. We build models, a lot of models, so there's a matrix of models, so when the candidate comes in, given the conditions that he need to be, it's possible to hire him in certain geos and sites, and because all the other part of the tests are okay, then he will have a ranking for each open position. That can be 1, 2, 3 models for small countries, up to 11 for very large countries. And it's not really readable, but one of the things that are quite curious to that we learned at the beginning. That's the first test we took. It was in Hermosillo in Mexico, that serves the US market. Is that this is the network? Okay. So my dad scientist, who is brilliant, said that this is the left and the right hemisphere of the brain. And I don't know. Maybe you will have the slide. You might believe it or not. But what is extremely interesting is that when you take the traditional labor psychology approach, the way you would do this is you take an expert, a consultant, he would observe people, make interviews and so on, and decide with his own brain what are the characteristics to be successful in the position. He would describe them, then he would go on the market and take tests that are proven to select people that have those characteristics. then you would hire people with these kind of tests, and you would try to see if the test has a positive impact on the performance. What we do is we have no theory about what's important. We just let the combination of performance and answer of agents tell us what is important for that position. So typically for one job family, so to be a teleseller or a technical desk guy, you would have one description, because our brain cannot understand all the subtle granularity of the differences that there are within this job family. First models we did, same size, so no cultural difference. All Mexican people answering to US customers, but three large programs, Reliant Energy, so it's utility, DirecTV and Comcast, so it's exactly the same vertical. So very similar process and so on. The three models are different. So if you take one average model, it's blurry. If you divide the models and you make three profiles, they are much more effective. Even between Comcast and DirecTV, which are exactly the same vertical, because customer satisfaction is completely different. The level of aggressiveness of people calling is completely different. The culture of the company and the style of management is completely different and so on. So in the end, it looks the same for human brain, but for Bayesian, it's not the same. Comcast is one of the worst customer satisfaction globally in the US. It's published on public index, so it's not a secret. And they're very close to Prantus under pressure. So you need an agent that is able to cope with the kind of requests he gets from the customer base. So the final outcome is that with this solution, the agent, they have a better experience. They're more engaged, they stay longer, they like their job more. Customers have a better experience because because of two factors. The person fits with the job, so she performs better. They stay longer. So in the distribution of the seniority of the agents, you have less new people that are going through the learning curve. So the average performance has two reasons for improving. The client has a much better performance. There's no additional cost for him because we are saving a lot of money, so we won't charge the client for the model. And in the end, we have a differentiator. We save a lot of money on training, and we perform better. So that just some example of KPIs of the different tests of the initial years. Minus 40% attrition, minus 30% in our country, plus 20%, 8% sales, minus 20% absenteeism, plus 20% customer satisfaction, plus 20% first resolution, and so on.
So, did you use Bayesian app to come up with the questions on the questionnaire, or was that completely independent?
It was a 5 years work to put the questionnaire together. So we took, we made workshops with all the HR departments of all the many large companies we have, and we analyzed their approach. We brainstormed, and we had a lab question that was huge, and we took years of tests to see what was more predictive in terms of having the best possible gain curve with a number of possible, which Bayesian is obviously one of them, and now Bayesian Lab is the solution on which the API are embedded on the platform. It's the solution we use to build models and to run the predictive part. So the scoring in real time is done by Bayesian app, but it's a never-ending work. So we know that out of 110 questions that we are now using, we have a ranking, and some of them they rank really badly, so they are predictive in very few cases. So if you take out 10 questions out of the questionnaire, and maybe somewhere you can take a lab and take some more question, you're going to continue on, because the 10 questions today, they're asked potentially to 1 million candidates. So it's 10 million questions less. So it's a lot of time.
Your model, you have to keep the questions the same all the time.
The, They are almost the same, because we are, otherwise the candidate comes in and we don't have the same structure of data to run the predictor. They're almost the same, but for legal reason, they're not exactly the same, because the labor laws and privacy laws are so much different and changing in every country that there is a master questionnaire, and most countries are exactly using it, and some countries have their own questionnaire. But yes, it needs to be stable enough. It took 5 years to convince the performance to sign a contract to deploy. And it's a daily fight, because it's so scientific that it's not in the mindset of my colleagues. Thank you. Thank you.